The logical interpretation of quantum mechanics based on the duality of time theory. In this video, we shall explain how the duality of time theory could provide the first logical interpretation of quantum mechanics. It will be also shown how this theory could unify all fundamental interactions and led to full quantum field theory of gravity. Don't forget to watch the previous video in which we explained how all the three principles of special and general relativity are derived from the duality of time postulate. The duality of time postulate states that at every instance of the outward normal level of time, space and matter are perpetually being recreated in one linear chronological sequence, which forms the inward levels of time that are also nested inside each lower dimension of space. This means that at every instance of the real flow of time, there is only one metaphysical point, that is the unit of space-time geometry, and the universe is a result of its perpetual recurrence in the inner levels of time, which is continuously and perpetually recreating the dimensions of space and what it may contain of matter particles, which then kinetically evolve throughout the outer normal level of time that we encounter.
This geometrical point is the single monad that has been explained in the first volume of this series.
The foundations of quantum mechanics were established during the first half of the 20th century, based on various experimental observations which confirmed that light as well as matter sometimes behave as spreading waves and sometimes as localized particles. Although it has been successfully applied in quantum mechanics, this wave-particle duality is still an ongoing conundrum in modern physics. And it is actually rooted in the ancient philosophical dispute between the continuous and discrete structure of space, or the atomic and substance theories of matter. The problem is that particles and waves are two contrasting phenomena, so they cannot describe the same thing at the same time. Einstein summarized this problem by saying, "We have two contradictory pictures of reality. Separately, neither of them fully explains the phenomena of light, but together they do." The wave-particle duality is deeply embedded into the foundations of quantum mechanics, because all the information about a particle is encoded in its wave function that evolves according to the Schrödinger equation. Even for particles with mass, this equation has solutions that follow the form of the wave equation, whose propagation leads to wave-like phenomena such as interference and diffraction. What is even more perplexing is that these wave phenomena are sometimes exhibited by single particles that are moving separately from each other, as in single particle interference experiments. Feynman confirmed that such phenomena are absolutely impossible to explain in any classical way. Additionally, because of this weird wave nature of particles, it is impossible to determine the position and momentum at the same time. This theoretical limit is called the uncertainty principle, which also implies that the observer inevitably affects the results of the observation. Other weird consequences also include quantum entanglement and the famous EPR experiment, which leads to non-local interactions that violate the principles of relativity. Actually, the wave-particle duality is a fundamental fact of nature that cannot be explained on the level of physical multiplicity, where things are either discrete or continuous, not the two together. However, according to the single monad model and the complex time geometry that resulted from the duality of time postulate, discreteness and continuity are two emergent properties of the same one linear flow of time, which is perpetually recreating objects in the inner continuous levels as waves, and displaying them in the outer discrete level as particles. Originally, the real flow of time is infinitesimally continuous because it is a result of the continuous revolution of the single monad that is perpetually recreating the cosmos at the speed of light. But as this single monad turns from one individual state to the other, each one individual state will encounter a discrete interval of time, which is the second level that is encountered outwardly, and that is why it appears imaginary with relation to the previous level. So, on the primary level of time, space is being continuously created, and each instance of the whole space will appear as one point in the secondary level of time that we normally encounter. Any kind of measurement or detection necessarily means that the single monad at this particular instance of measurement is manifesting as the observer that is now acting on the system. And since there is only one real state at the real flow of time, the system must necessarily collapse at this particular instance of the real time. Of course, this collapsing is not fatal. Otherwise, particles and objects will disappear forever. But they are recreated or excited again right after this instantaneous collapse, at which time the observer now would have moved back into an indeterminate state and become an object amongst other objects. In other words, in the inner levels of time, things behave as waves, and in the outer level they become localized as physical particles, but only for the indivisible instance of time when they are observed. If we suppose the particle is composed of n individual points, or monads, each of which is an instance of the single monad, that is the only entity that exists in the real flow of time, then the total velocity of the particle is the time average of the velocities of all individual points, each of which is either at rest or moving at the speed of light at the particular single instance of the time of measurement. Therefore, in an object a particle of n individual points, because only one point exists in the real flow of time on the inner level of perpetual creation, the position of one of these points will be completely uncertain, because its velocity is equal to c, while the rest have been already defined, because they are now in the past, and their velocities have sequentially and abruptly collapsed from c to zero, after they have made their specific contribution to the total quantum state, when the number n is very large. As it is the case with large objects and heavy particles, the uncertainty will be very small, because only one point is completely uncertain at the real instance of time. But for small particles, such as the electron, the uncertainty could be considerably large. This uncertainty will also increase with momentum, because higher physical velocity simply means that on average more and more points are in real motion rather than rest. This explains all the puzzling features of quantum mechanics, such as uncertainty, the measurement problem of the effect of observers and consciousness, as well as the reality of wave function and its collapse, as it has been demonstrated in more detail in Chapter 6 of the Duality of Time Theory. All these calculations are described in detail in Chapter 5 of the Duality of Time book.
إني ببابك قد بسطت يدي ما لي ألوذ به إياك يا سندي
مولاي.